album itself, the audaciously titled Second Coming, was greeted by the music press with disappointment. It was described as anally indulgent, a paean to Led Zeppelin, a step backwards. Though they were possibly a bit hacked off by the band's exclusive album interview with The Big Issue, the music press implied the dream was over. With hindsight, the album now seems to many to have been chronically underrated.
When your heart is black and broken, and you need a helping hand, when you're so much in love, you don't know just how much you can stand. When your questions go unanswered, and the silence is killing you, take my hand, baby, I'm your man. I got love.
In 1995, the first real death blow struck the band when Reni, long considered the greatest rock drummer of his generation, left the band. The real reason for his departure has never been made clear. He was always quite a mysterious figure.
I've never met Reni, but from what you hear about from people who know him, he's a bit mental anyway. So it's like, a lot of people didn't really think that he'd left anyway, until Robbie joined, and it was like, oh, so he has left. So, like, he's proper left. Everyone's like, yeah, he's proper left. I just thought he'd gone off his head for a bit. A lot of people in Manchester actually thought when they first seen the Stone Roses that he was the star of the band, because he used to sing as well, and I've seen him do some outrageous things on a drum kit. I mean, it'd be like Keith Moon leaving The Who or something like that. It's the same as like Aziz trying to replace John Squire. I mean, it's like, you don't do things like that.
He just didn't want to do it anymore. Got so depressed and pissed off with it. Trying to relight your spark after having it snuffed out for a few years, it's very difficult for everybody. And maybe I think Reni saw a vision of how it was going, you know, before anybody else. Very intelligent lad. I was pretty gutted, actually, but I thought I could see the reasons why I didn't want to do it.
Robbie Maddox replaced Reni, and the band gave a typically reticent but oddly prophetic interview to Radio 1's Joe Whiley.
Sounds good. It's playing again. Rehearsing this week. Ready to go again. That's if we don't split up or lose our battle.
The last time that you were here, if you don't mind talking about it, Reni was here. Have you seen him, had any contact with him lately?
He's been in Spain.
Doing what, on holiday?
Yeah.
Did he need to take a holiday to take a break?
Dunno. Should ask him next time he's here.
Have you not had any contact with him?
No.
Still, there were some brilliant gigs left in the Roses, as their late 95 tour proved. Just when it looked like it might be safe to start believing in them again, disaster struck. John Squire left the band. The Roses' bitter response to his leaving, first demonstrated at their 1996 Reading Festival press conference, shocked many of their fans.
He hasn't wanted to play with me since 1991. He hasn't wanted to play with Reni since 1991. He hasn't wanted to play with Manny since 1991. He hasn't wanted to play with any of us. Where do you think we've been all this time? I've been knocking on his bedroom door asking him to come out to be with us.
Because he felt his power threatened, because we was all getting a bit too good for him.
We were too strong for him and we were too nice to him. That's what's happened. But because the kid's so meek and quiet, I was there for him. Let him do this thing, let him get this out of his system. That's what he wants to do. I'm with him, because we've got all the time in the world.
1 from 5 is 4. Wouldn't even bother to phone my house if he heard my mum, dad, everybody who was ever in my lineage was killed in a motorway crash. Because he can't be asked to get out of his bedroom.
He became friends with a bag of cocaine. He put that before his friends. It's a filthy business, but it hasn't touched us yet. It's a filthy business, it hasn't touched us yet.
And a follow-up Radio 1 interview, including replacement guitarist Aziz, did little to quell the fans' beating heart.
Not interested in running out, giving flyers out, saying we still exist. We just get on with it, let people speculate all the time.
Guitarists are 10 a penny, man. It's not about replacing them, it's about going on with a new style, man, and a new thing. John was good at his time and he'd done the LP that he wanted last time. It's Led Zepp fantasy. But we're above all that, man. Never really liked him anyway.
I suppose it is kind of strange in the sense of taking on somebody else's parts. So once I play them, they become my own. It was like I was meant for this band in the first place, and some joker was there before me. What can I say?
Manny.
I never want to expose any weakness to the press, because that's what they're looking for. And they were all there looking for it that day anyway, you know, and they'd all sat there like they'd come and see a funeral and could be given what they wanted. Great. John was left with no option but to take off, because certain members of the band weren't pulling it out live. I hate blushing on stage in front of people, but I'd always play my part. I think there was lapses of concentration going on. I was a bit angry with John when he left the group at first, but then I think it was poisoned a little bit. I was maybe being a bit selfish and thinking about myself and the rest of us, but the more I think about it, he was left with no option. He had to leave. I stayed with Ian because I didn't want to be deserting him and leaving him in it too. Maybe it was the wrong thing to do. In fact, I know it was the wrong thing to do. I should have left there and then, but my stupid loyalty kept me with him. He's a friend, you know, so I had to stick by him.
Adored, the story of the Stone Roses on Radio 1.
This is the day we meet, and this is the love we make. But love is the law here, you got to know how to love it, yeah. It's more than a mover, you know it takes all fast or strong. So cold wild, bring a loving song, brother man, true nature child. Georgia, alongside Manchester, everyone ready, so, so willing and able, yeah, 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 for the love you make. To make ya, we are love makers, ain't we? Sister Rosalie Parks, love forever, her name in your heart, forever in my heart.
The band's public united front, Manny had already told them he was leaving after the Reading show. The Roses maintain to this day that their performance at Reading was not unusually bad, but Ian's broken voice and the low quality of the new songs had the press proclaiming the death of the Stone Roses the next day. Melody maker journalist Jennifer Nine was one of the reviewers who came to that conclusion.
When they finally came out and just the first few guitar chords and just the way they sounded, I thought, felt like my heart was in my mouth, and I don't know how many seconds that is, like 10 seconds till the vocals come in, and for 10 seconds it was like the best gig experience in my life. And then Ian Brown's, when he opened his mouth, it was like a bad joke. I've never seen anything like that on a stage before, anything. He was bellowing like he could not hear and he couldn't think and couldn't remember the lyrics. There'd be people with hands up to their mouths and there were people crying. There were definitely people crying. I was crying by the end of it. And he kept looking out into the audience and, oh, you're pretty quiet out there. Someone just said, it's the shock, mate. He couldn't sing. He wasn't there. He didn't know.
But Reading, it just looked like he's detached from the whole thing, you know, it's really odd. So just, he's going through the motions, and when the drummer started going, come on, everyone, clap your hands, and like, oh, that dancing girl, it was like, Jesus Christ. It's not even Stone Rose anymore, it's a Robbie Maddox 5, isn't it? He stood there thinking, that's it, this is the end.
And for John Robb, the show made clear that the mantle had been passed on.
And then I said, a gig at Reading or something, I was watching that, there's these kids to next to me going, look at him up there, Liam Brown, he looks, he thinks he's Liam Gallagher. I was thinking, Jesus, that's really weird, thing going like kind of full circle, aren't it, you know?
Did you ever feel the pain in the morning rain as it soaks you to the bone? Maybe I just wanna play, wanna live but don't wanna die. Maybe I just wanna breathe, maybe I just don't believe.
A few weeks later, the Stone Roses officially split up, and Manny announced that he was joining Primal Scream. The Primals continue to be one of the pioneers in the current British rock scene, as influenced by the Roses, as the Roses were once influenced by them. In fact, the influence of the Roses is all over this week's charts, from the Verve to the Charlatans to Oasis.
I remember when the first time that I wandered in to see Oasis, and Liam was like incredibly charismatic. Like total presence, the kind of presence that Ian Brown sort of had, although it wasn't like Ian Brown, but it's the same sort of haunting kind of presence. Up in the Sky, off the first LP that they played that night, is for me, is like a total Stone Roses homage, really. And me being me, went away thinking, I never went away thinking Oasis was going to be the biggest group in the country and probably the world one day. I just thought I might be able to sell 500,000 albums and be as big as the Stone Roses.
They were our band, I suppose, because we got on it before anybody else in England, and then they made us feel special. And of course, at that time, there was all the Manchester-London thing. If thou from Manchester, thou shalt inherit the earth, you know, Tony Wilson used to say. And then they sung in Manchester accents, they wore the same clothes, they went to the same clubs, you know, you could see them down, you know, the same shots where you were buying, you know, the same Army and Navy shots where you were buying your desert boots and your flare jeans. But all that aside, really, in the cold light of day, means nothing now. What you're left with is like the music. Pure and simply boils down to that they, you know, wrote some of the greatest songs of the late 80s.
Noel Gallagher isn't shy about his debt to the Squire Brown writing partnership.
If you play Cloudburst, which in the way that Radio 1 compiles these documentaries, Cloudburst will now be playing, or right about now. And then if you play Standing Here by the Stone Roses, which will be fading in right about now. You'll find that they're both exactly the same tune.
I see the wheel keeps turning. Manny went along to the Mercury Music Prize this year to represent Primal Scream after their Vanishing Point album was nominated for the award. John Squire found himself another writing partner and is currently in the charts with the Seahorses' fourth big hit, You Can Talk To Me.
Don't you think that maybe I should slow down? I've got so many things to say, I had to write them down. I was feeling alone, so I'm on the phone to you.